Welcome back, guys. My name is Chris, and in this video, we're going to be talking about EDI in NetSuite. Now, EDI, if you don't already know, stands for Electronic Data Interchange, and it is simply a system or a means of communicating between two systems, as the name implies, using this electronic exchange of files. And it is by no means a sophisticated or a modern kind of like cutting edge system. It's actually something that's been around for a very long time. What makes it still commonly used is the fact that in certain industries and circumstances, it's just predominantly used. For example, and what we're gonna talk about here is if you've got a setup between your NetSuite account and let's say a client of yours that is a retail chain, especially a larger one, they often use EDI as a means of exchanging information about orders, shipments, etc. between the two systems. So it is very, very commonly used. Even though it is an older system, it's pretty reliable, and there's a lot of benefits of going with a system like that. Now, I did talk about this a little bit in a recent video I made called Consumer Packaged Goods. Probably came out with that about a month ago, but I want to dive a little bit deeper into just EDI as opposed to that entire industry and talk a little bit more about what it means to implement EDI, what are some of the upsides, downsides, etc. So with that in mind, let's first take a look at what are the various suppliers or implementers for EDI. And there's a number of them, but really there's a few that stand out. Most importantly, you've got SPS Commerce, True Commerce, Clio Integration Cloud. There's also Soligo, which generally just does normal API connections. Also recently came out with something called B2B Manager, which is their EDI option. Now, when you're looking at these various options, and sometimes people reach out to me and ask, which one do I recommend and which one is best? I would say more generally that they're all equally bad. And I'm not going to say that you shouldn't go with any one of them. It's just that, as you'll see through the remainder of this video, EDI integrations and implementations can be difficult. They can take a long time. There's quite a bit of technical complexity that can go along with that. And when it comes to these companies, it's not that they do a terrible job. It's just that their focus is on the software. And so when their team does an implementation, they can be frustrating. I'll give a little bit more information on that a little later in this video. But the point is, I wouldn't look at doing one over the other. So with that in mind, let's now jump over into a graphic that I showed in my previous video. So we're gonna open that up now. And in this graphic, we're gonna lay out how EDI actually works between the trading partner, your NetSuite system, and then your third-party logistics. Now, it's not mandatory for consumer packaged goods companies to have a 3PL, but it's so common that we might as well talk about it. In other words, you've got some external company that's handling your shipping and the logistics, and so you're gonna have to communicate back and forth with your 3PL. So we're gonna set up this graphic where we have these three swim lanes, trading partner, NetSuite, 3PL, and look at how, just for a normal order, how this thing flows through from start to finish. Now, obviously, to start things off, we're gonna have an order comes in. In the example we gave earlier, Whole Foods is the company that we're dealing with as our trading partner. So I'm just gonna call it an order in the graphic, but you have to understand from Whole Foods' standpoint, it's actually a sales order. From our standpoint, as the business that has NetSuite, it is a purchase order to us. So we're gonna have that order start with Whole Foods, that then through the EDI connection, let's say it's through True Commerce, that then comes into us. Now I'm also gonna include next to that, you're gonna see as we go through this, there's always gonna at least be one number, in some cases it'll be two numbers, that indicate the code for that direction of flow, that file package that's coming over. Everything has a code when you're dealing with EDI. That's not specific to any one particular EDI implementation you're doing. That's for EDI in general. There's a generally agreed upon coding system so that you know if orders coming to us or orders going out from us to the 3PL, they all have their different codes. And it's really just a means of simplifying the system. So you can just refer to it by the code and immediately everyone who's dealing with this knows what you're talking about and exactly which direction the information is traveling. So in this particular case, when we have an order coming from the customer to us, that's referred to as an 850. It can also be referred to as an 875 for particular industries, such as if you're dealing with a grocery chain, you might hear it referred to as an 875. So with the receipt of that 850, we're gonna generate in NetSuite a sales order. So that sales order record is created, and from there, two things can happen. The first one is not mandatory, but very commonly you will see an instance where when the sales order is created, there's an acknowledgement that goes back to the trading partner so that they know we have in fact received it and we are processing their order. Now that order acknowledgement is particular to note because if it's a very simple circumstance where it's always gonna be, we get an order from Whole Foods and we simply notify them, we got your order, good to go, we've gotten started, then it's not necessarily a complex setup to put in that order acknowledgement. However, as soon as you start looking at the variety of things that can happen, for example, let's say the options are we acknowledge them and say we're gonna do their order. The second thing is we respond back and say we cannot do their order. Or maybe we're gonna tell them we can't do their order right now, but we can fulfill it in a couple weeks. Or maybe if they order 100 keto bars, we're gonna send back saying we only have 70 that we can fulfill, the remaining 30 will go at a different time. Or maybe we're gonna supply them with a different type of item in lieu of the remaining 30 that we can't supply them. There's so many other things that can happen in the order acknowledgement. Obviously, it depends to some degree on the relationship with the trading partner and what the agreements are. But when you start looking at a variety of different things that can go back out to the trading partner as an order acknowledgement, it gets significantly more complex in terms of how you implement that order acknowledgement. So from a technical standpoint, when you're actually setting these up, that 855, which is the order acknowledgement going back, can really start to lengthen out in terms of how long it takes just to set up that one piece of the puzzle. But also off of that sales order, we have a communication that goes to our 3PL, which is called the 940, and that informs them of the order and what they need to do to fulfill it. So that goes to the 3PL. Obviously, the 3PL does whatever they have to do to ship that order out. Let's say it's 100 keto bars. Once they've fulfilled that order, they need to communicate that back to us so that we can create the item fulfillment record in NetSuite. Now, once you have the item fulfillment in NetSuite, again, there's two things that happen at that point. There's a communication that can go back to our trading partner, which is often known as an 856 or an advanced shipping notice. This is a communication that's letting them know this thing has been shipped out and it can include other information, when they're going to receive it, as well as you can get quite a bit of detail in terms of the packing information. How much is on, let's say, the pallet? What's the weight? How is it composed? What is the exact packaging that's been done with it? And you can get into additional information just in terms of the logistical shipping requirements that are going out to the trading partner. And like I said, with that order acknowledgement, when you start adding more information into that advanced shipping notice, it can dramatically increase the time needed to implement that leg of communication, that 856. So that is one thing that comes off of the item fulfillment. And then of course, once you have an item fulfillment record in your NetSuite, you obviously then want to generate an invoice record in NetSuite. That then sparks off an invoice which will go to the trading partner so that they know what they need to pay us back for. At that point, this is the end of this transaction just from a simplicity standpoint. Obviously, accounts receivable will chase up the trading partner and make sure that the payments come in on time, et cetera, et cetera. But that is the basic flow, assuming we have a third-party logistics, of how EDI would facilitate the communication from trading partner to us, to our 3PL, and then eventually back to the trading partner. All right, now before we continue, if you're finding this video helpful, please hit that like button and subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. And if you're interested in full-length courses for NetSuite, please check out my website. I'll include a link for that down below. And you can see any one of, at this point, I have almost 20 courses all getting into various aspects of NetSuite. I come out with new courses almost every month. So by all means, check that out. So now let's get back to EDI. And at this point, let's talk a little bit about the EDI implementation, which I've alluded to quite a bit throughout this video. Unlike doing a normal API connection, let's say between your Salesforce and your NetSuite, if you've got both of those systems, where you're just doing a connection like Soligo between the two, those connections can generally, not necessarily with Salesforce, but with a lot of different things you're integrating in with NetSuite, they can be set up relatively quickly. Oftentimes you might be looking at implementations of just a few weeks to set various connections up. When you're looking at an EDI integration, it is a totally different ballpark. For the first trading partner, you should give yourself and think with a timeline of 4 to 6 weeks just to set up that first one. Every subsequent trading partner you may have, I would then look at an additional 1 to 2 weeks per trading partner. So if you have 10 trading partners, you might look at, let's say, 5 weeks for the first one. And then for the remaining 9, it could be 1 to 2 weeks per trading partner. You can easily see, let's say you're just going live on NetSuite, that EDI integration itself might push out that go live date by several months. Now, I'll give you a tip a little bit later in this video of how you can address that if that is a problem for you. But just understand, the implementation cycle is quite extensive. Now, there's a few reasons for that in terms of why it can take so long. It's not even that it's technically so difficult to set up EDI. It's more that it requires extensive testing to make sure that it is working appropriately. One of the major benefits of EDI is that it's going to be automating your entire process, where orders simply come straight in from your trading partner. It goes right to your 3PL. 3PL fulfills it, comes back to you, back to the trading partner, et cetera. All of these things can happen without a lot of manual intervention, and that is very beneficial. But to make sure that's going to work appropriately, you have to have the team go in, which the implementation is done by whoever you're partnering with. Let's say it's SPS Commerce, they're going to do the implementation. They need to come in and know exactly what information is going to be coming from the trading partner and then match that up perfectly to the exact fields you're going to have on your side of the system. And any kind of variety, they need to make sure they account for that. For every single flow, for every field, for every type of transaction and item from every single trading partner that you have, they have to test every single one of these things extensively. And all of that testing, all of those links up, it just takes time. That's simply the way it goes. It's not that it can't be done sooner, but if you're going to try to get it done sooner, you're going to have to put more manpower, more time into it, oftentimes at a greater expense, to try to expedite that process. So with that in mind, let's talk briefly about some tips on how you can have your EDI implementation go as smoothly as possible. And one of the number one things I tell people from a client standpoint is try to be the responsible person in the room. It can be very easy when you're getting an EDI implementation to look at things and say, all right, well, SPS Commerce is technically the EDI company, so they're responsible for doing the implementation. And then on top of that, I have my own consulting company, let's say RSM. They're doing my NetSuite implementation. So I've got two different teams that technically should be responsible for this implementation, and it's their problem. That is unfortunately not, I mean, you can do that if you want, but it's often not going to be a very successful approach because, like I've mentioned earlier, these EDI companies, their strength is not in their implementation. It's not like they have fast implementations. They don't give what I would call superlative work or customer support in working through that implementation. They're making and selling software. So they will do the implementation. It's just sometimes they can drag their feet. Sometimes they can be hard to reach. You know, if you've got a go live that's going to happen on Monday, don't expect them to be reachable on Saturday and Sunday if there's things that need to be tested. You just need to be thinking with these things. And also when it comes to your normal NetSuite consulting partner, they are oftentimes, I'm not going to say for all companies, but I have noticed that oftentimes the consulting company will say, that's SPS Commerce's problem, not ours. We have our own go live issues that we need to deal with. So talk to them if you're having any problems with that. That's why I would just recommend, if you're doing one of those EDI implementations, it's unlike the rest of the things you're dealing with in NetSuite, where you can just be in touch with your consulting partner. Now you're dealing with a whole nother team, and you need to make sure they will need to work with your consulting team. You have to make sure that you're facilitating and that they are in communication with each other, that everyone's on the same page in terms of what needs to happen, what that timeline looks like, et cetera, et cetera. Also keep in mind, a great way to do that is to make sure there's plenty of lucid charts similar to the one I just showed you earlier in this video, so that everyone knows what are the exact flows. You should definitely be familiar with the codes for every leg of communication, and just make sure that you are being responsible for that implementation. Now, as I mentioned earlier, one tip, if you've got a lot of training partners and you're really tight on time and you do not have, let's say, 6 months to add 15 different trading partners, you've got 2 months before your NetSuite go live. One thing you can do is you can focus on your core trading partners. Let's say out of 15 in total, there's three that are your absolute core part of your business. They make so much up of your revenue. Those are the three that you want to prioritize. The remaining 12 can be handled using EDI portals, which I don't want to go into too much detail on that, but you can set up where even without an EDI integration, you can log into a portal and manually check out what are the orders, etc. So you can handle that with the remaining 12 trading partners and get the three integrated with the actual EDI integration before your go live date. After you've gone live, when things have chilled out a little bit, then on a more extended timeline, when there's not a lot of pressure, you can do the remaining implementations. Just keep in mind that no matter which EDI company you're dealing with, let's say it's TrueCommerce, they often will consider that first leg of implementation with the three partners totally different than the remaining 12. They'll have a new statement of work, new pricing, maybe a new team that's doing that final 12 integrations. So just keep that in mind. That's another thing you may run into. And that's your overview on the subject of EDI. Hopefully this was informative for you. And if you want to check out more on the subject of consumer packaged goods, by all means, check out that other YouTube video I made. And if you have any remaining questions on the subject of EDI, feel free to reach out to me by email. I'm more than happy to answer questions as far as I can. So with all of that in mind, I hope to see you in the next video.